continuing our parable series today, and if you notice, these teachings that Jesus has given us in Matthew are all about the kingdom of heaven. And a lot of you talk to teenagers today, and even some adults, and they say, well, it's like, man, you know, it's like everything. Jesus is teaching the same way. It's like this, to help people understand and describe what he's talking about, the kingdom of heaven, because it's not anything that we have seen or can experience here on earth, we think, but it is what he's saying. So these parables are teachings. Today we're going to hear three of the parables that he kind of lumped together in Matthew for the purpose of making a point. And the point is about the abundance of God's kingdom. The mustard seed that grows into a tree is over here. And I believe the pearl, the treasure that's buried in the field. And I don't think we have to know because I didn't put that up on Irma's screen. But he told them together, so we're going to use it. We'll probably revisit a couple of those. But I want you to take a minute and just think, did you ever realize the long-term impact that just the smallest change can make in our lives? Have you ever realized that you make a small change, what a huge impact it can have in your life? Let me give you an example. Eating one less candy bar a day or drinking one less Coke a day means losing 10 pounds over the course of a year. That may not seem like a lot, but 10 pounds is 10 pounds if you want to lose weight. Or if you save a dollar a day over the course of a typical career, you could accumulate approximately $200,000 because of compounding interest. Or reading the Bible for just 10 minutes every day, and you can read the entire Bible in the course of a year. Small changes, it seems like, but if they are nurtured continuously over a period of time, they can make a huge difference in our lives. Jesus promised his followers that it could be like the kingdom of God. We can live a life that's like the kingdom of God if we really wanted to and if we applied ourselves. Small beginnings with some leaven of faith, we put a little faith and a willingness to sacrifice to pay the price, can produce amazing results. So Jesus told a parable about a mustard seed, which is just a tiny, tiny little seed and grows into a great tree that actually provides abundant space and living and food for the birds and the squirrels and other animals. And then he told about something that he probably saw his mother do quite often. Put a little lump of yeast into the bread dough, and soon he would see the flour start to expand and grow and get bigger. Next comes a story that Jesus, that you heard Rob read, of a simple metaphor of a treasure that's hidden in a field, and a man who spent a lot of money to buy the field just to get the treasure. Put it together, or taking it individually, these stories teach us a great lesson to us disciples gathered here today, who often get lost in counting the cost, or thinking about the possibility of failure, or the meager size of a project compared to the problems that we're going to need to address, and we never get started in the first place. We start thinking about all the obstacles, all the problems, all the challenges, and we never get going. But Jesus said, don't underestimate how a little beginning can grow and grow into spectacular results. These stories teach us a special principle that Jesus is trying to let us adopt and get into our heads and get it into our lives. What he's saying, here's a principle. God can do a lot with just a little. That's important to know when you think you only have a little to offer God. It's an important understanding for us who are trying to be faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. The coming of God's kingdom, it causes change. It causes transformation in your life. And it's as dramatic as the yeast in the dough. Do you know how crazy that can get? Have you ever seen what happens putting yeast in dough? And if you don't watch it and you don't get back, it can get crazy. Where's Joyce? She makes her bread every month, and it multiplies and multiplies. But that's how it can be. A commitment can be that dramatic in our lives. And it most often starts with a tiny, insignificant, what the world would call unimportant beginning. Jesus is teaching the principle of abundance. Abundance. God can do a lot with a little. Today we're going to look primarily at the story of the mustard seed and the mustard tree. And I want us to consider three things today to experiencing God's abundance in our lives. Pay attention, because this is a shorter message today for those of you who are here. For those who missed it, they had their opportunity. I won't do those again. So tell them, all right? We're going to be short to the point. We're not going to have a TED talk, but we're going to have a Jesus talk. So here's the three keys I want you to think about to experiencing abundance in our lives. Many of you here today may not realize it, but, and there's others who know it, you have spent many years of your lives dealing with some kind of poverty of one kind or another. And I'm not talking just about money this morning. I'm referring to other types of poverty for different kinds of lack that we have in our lives. For example, some people want to have a fulfilling and a meaningful career or a job, you know, that you can love, and it makes a difference in people's lives. People are lacking. They want a job that they can do that makes a difference, but they just can't seem to get it off the ground. Some people want to have a better marriage, but your relationship with your spouse seems to be in a perpetual step of one step forward, two steps back. Some people want to have a dynamic relationship with God. They want to increase their faith life. You want to grow in holiness and obedience, and you want your prayer life to be fruitful, and you want it to be vibrant and exciting. But it seems year after year, your prayer life, you feel like you're spinning your wheels and all the good intentions are getting nowhere. And you just can't make the changes that you want to make. Jesus' teaching is saying the key to creating that kind of change, the key to experiencing the abundance of God and His blessings in the kingdom of God can be found in the parable of the mustard seed. That parable teaches us God can take a little and do a whole lot with it. The smallest decision that you make can make a huge difference in your life. But there are some supplemental truths that we need to abide by, and Jesus tells that when He explains the parables. First of all, it starts that you have to make a decision. You've got to make the decision to do it. For the farmer, it began with a decision to take that mustard seed, plant it in a field. And once he planted that small seed, he was on his way to experiencing a harvest. That wasn't the only step in the process, but you can see it's the most important one, isn't it? If you're lacking the fullness of God's blessing in your life right now, it's because there's a decision that has yet to be made. There is a decision that is yet to be made. Maybe you need to decide to follow through and start reading your Bible every day. Maybe you need to decide to distance yourself from some sin. Maybe you need to decide to pursue a new career path. Maybe you need to decide to turn your marriage over to God. Maybe you need to decide to turn your life over to God. Maybe you need to make a decision to stick with a decision that you made in the past. Maybe you need to make a decision to extend the grace and forgiveness that Jesus Christ has shown you to somebody else. The key to eliminating lack begins with taking that first step. You need to go into the field, like the farmer in the parable, and you need to plant the seed. You need to make a decision, no matter how small that person, that step may seem. Nothing good can result in your life without it, without making that step. You've heard the saying that a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. In the same way, experiencing God's abundance in your life, and it may be just God's abundant presence that you're lacking in your life. It begins with a single decision to let Him into your life. The kingdom of God is like that. Some of you can remember what seemed like a small decision in the past that you're experiencing the blessings of today, perhaps. Adam, you made a decision a little over 2 years ago to stop using drugs, didn't you? And look at the difference now. Whole different life, and you're in the Bible, in the Word, in Bible study, teaching children's church, because you made a decision 2 years ago. Some of you made a seemingly insignificant decision to attend church one Sunday, and you've been faithful, and that decision has changed your lifestyle. Years ago, some of you made a decision that you were going to be a generous and joyful giver. You decided to tithe. That decision opened the door of God's blessings for you and for more in life than you could have ever imagined. Probably some of it you don't even know came from that move, but if you think about it, you can see how it did. Some of you stepped out in faith and took the 90-day challenge a few weeks ago, and you may have already experienced some changes, some blessings, just because you made the decision to do that. It certainly brought you closer to God, or it should. Some of you made a decision to pray for a friend, or maybe you made a decision to talk to somebody about Jesus, and that decision changed the course of that other person's destiny and their history, because you made a decision to talk to them and tell them. That's powerful. The decisions you make are the first step in the process of what God can accomplish in your life. Think about it. Just think about it. What decision do you need to make today? What is the decision that you need to make today? And you know it. It's been coming for a long time, and you need to make that decision. Secondly, to experience God's abundance, you need to remember that follow-up is necessary. Follow-up is required. The farmer didn't plant the mustard seed in the field and then go on vacation. He had to water the plant, he had to take care of it, he had to make sure that it rooted, he had to make sure that it didn't get choked out by the weeds that we talked about last week. Though change begins with a simple decision, there's more to it than that. They must be nurtured and developed, and they must be consistently revisited. Each decision that we make requires follow-up, doesn't it? What do I mean? Let's say that you make a decision that you want to grow spiritually. That decision is going to have to be nurtured, isn't it? Like the mustard seed that requires water, fertilizer, sunlight, your decision requires further attention. You follow up your decision by developing habits like reading the Bible, going to Bible study, prayer, by learning how to imitate Jesus Christ through reading the Word and finding out about Him. The small seed of your original decision has the capacity to grow into something big, something huge in your life, but it needs to be nurtured along the way. We can't just plant the seed, forget about it, expect God to do all the work. It's the same point that Jesus was making when he said in verse 33, the kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and she mixed into a large amount of flour until she worked it through the dough. That small amount of yeast causes the bread to rise, but the yeast must be worked into the dough. The yeast must be nurtured, so to speak, until it permeates the dough. And what's the lesson here? Jesus is making the lesson here is that good decisions require constant, long-term care to pay off. I can't tell you how many goal-setting books and goal-setting seminars I've been to for the conference and for ministry continuing education that they require. And I've read many books and seminars on the subject of goal-setting. And it seems to suggest when we do goal-setting that there's something magical about setting goals. And I really don't like that because that's not the truth. As if deciding that I want to make $100,000 a year is going to miraculously cause your income to increase to $100,000 a year. That isn't the case. Goal setting is a good habit. It's a great habit. There's no doubt about it. But it is not enough. Goal setting is not enough. It is the original seed. Okay? That's the first step. But the seed has to be nurtured in order to grow. The yeast has to be worked for the dough in order for it to rise. A moment ago, I challenged you to ask yourself, what decision do you need to make? The next question I'm going to ask you right now is, what must I do to nurture that decision? What do I need to do to follow up and nurture that decision? What follow-up is required? What do I have to do in order to make sure that this decision has an opportunity to develop? Once a decision is made, it needs to be nurtured. That's called commitment. Third thing I want you to remember today is that it could take a long time to see results. The farmer who planted the mustard seed on Monday, he didn't expect to have a full-grown mustard tree on Tuesday, did he? He knew that there was a period of time, and it's actually a rather long period of time, in which the seed would develop and it would grow into a plant. Jesus uses this metaphor of a mustard seed, the tiniest of seeds, to symbolize the kind of faith that his followers, you and I, need to embrace. Over time, a mustard seed grows, it blossoms, it matures, but it takes steady nurture, the right conditions, and plenty of long-term patient vision to hang on. In the same way, true faith results in the long haul, for us to have true discipleship. That's what disciples of Jesus Christ do. Accept his teaching, his parables, apply it to their lives, hang on for the long haul to see the results in their lives and the lives of others. It starts small and it grows gradually, steadily, intentionally. It works and it does make a difference. Your decision, say, to lose weight, your decision to improve your marriage, to become obedient, may not be immediately obvious to other people. They don't know that's the decision that you made, or even to yourself. It may take a long time before you start seeing results. But God's promise is that the results will ultimately come. That's God's promise, if you hold on and do that. Is that enough for you? A few years ago, my niece Julie weighed over 400 pounds. She made a decision to lose weight. She followed up by a decision with some necessary changes in her lifestyle. She actually had some surgery. She began eating healthy food and she began exercising. After about 6 months, she lost 50 pounds. But no one noticed. And she really didn't look a whole lot different. She later told me that was the most discouraging time for her. When she had reached her first major plateau, her first goal of losing 50 pounds, and you could not tell the difference. By the time she lost another 50 pounds, people started to recognize the difference, to see the change, especially people who hadn't seen her for a while. But it took almost a year, she said, before anybody said anything to her about it. Now, after 2.5 years, she had reached her goal of losing more than 240 pounds. Today, she looks great. She's a totally different person. But it took a long time for her to see the results. But it was worth it. It was worth it in the long run. We have a tendency to want a quick fix in our lives, don't we? Quick fix to our problems. We want God to fix our marriage overnight that has been suffering from years of neglect. We want God to turn around our business in just a matter of days, even though we have sown years of poor decisions into it. We want God to make us holy with the snap of his fingers, even though we haven't done what it takes to develop spiritual maturity. For most of the problems we face, there aren't any easy cures. There's not any quick fixes. When we make the decision to give God control of a specific area of our lives, we have to approach that decision with the understanding that we may not see the results for days, for weeks, for months, or maybe even years. Some people say, well then, why bother then? If I can't make this problem go away immediately, why should I even try? Here's why. Because in 5 years, your life will reflect the decision that you make today. 5 years from now, you are either going to be struggling with the same sins, the same bad habits, the same problems, or 5 years from now, you will be experiencing the blessings and abundance of God in your life. It all depends on the decision you make today. Your future is shaped by your decision. The decisions that you are making right now and the life you lead today is a result of a decision that you made in the past. Realizing that should move you all to consider the power of our decisions. One seemingly small decision to include God in your life, to give God control of every area of your life, can make a huge outcome. A huge difference in the outcome of your life. If you let that decision take its course, it will make a huge difference in your life. So I want you to remember three things. Ask yourself today, what decision do I need to make today? A decision to make your marriage better? To begin a new career? To lose weight? To get closer to your children? To become more dynamic Christian, to learn to live in more obedience to Christ, what decision is it that you need to make today? Next question. What do I need to nurture? Do I need to find a prayer partner? Do I need to join a health club, get in a small group? Do you need to begin taking your wife out on a date night each week? Do you need to take a personal retreat? Get away, get your thoughts straightened out, and get your act together. Do you need to go back to school and get the degrees required for that better job? What do you need to do to follow through on that decision? Third question, are you willing to wait as long as it takes? If in 3 months you haven't seen any change in the way your spouse relates to you, are you still willing to keep trying? If in 6 months your business is still struggling, are you willing to keep working at it? If in 12 months you're still struggling with some besetting sin or habit or hang-up or hurt that you're carrying on to or holding on to, are you willing to keep fighting for the victory? Are you willing to wait to see the results? It is the kingdom of God. It is small like a mustard seed, silent like leaven, a surprise like a treasure found in a field, and as priceless as a precious pearl. the power of a good decision. Think about it. It can open the door for God's kingdom in your life and for God's abundant blessings that He so wants to give to us. One small decision can make a huge outcome, difference in the outcome of your life, if you keep God at the center of your life. That's what Jesus wants us to take from the mustard seed. The parable of the mustard seed. A small seed with a whole lot of faith, a small decision with a whole lot of faith can change our lives. I pray that it will be so for you and those around you. Let's pray together this morning. Father God, I thank you for leading us and guiding us. And Jesus, we just thank you for your teachings. Teachings that help us to relate and understand how they apply to our lives today, so many years later, Lord. Give us the strength we need to make the decisions. Give us, Lord, the faith to believe, the diligence to hang on and stay committed, and the patience to see the results. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.